Hope it is visible.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
It is.
Yeah, good afternoon. So today's topic, I have selected a topic because the topic of this program is on materials. So I have selected a topic covering a particular type of materials, which we are increasingly being using it, which is called geosynthetic. And I'll be covering, actually, geosynthetic has numerous applications. So only one type of applications, which is related to the reinforcement of soils and other materials. So for engineers, materials is very, very important. And throughout history also, we have to learn the terms like Stone Age, Bronze Age, Iron Age, because depending on the most prominent type of materials of that time, for making tools, weapons, etc., we call it. So today, I don't know what should we call now. It could be like a plastic age, because plastics are, whether for good and bad, both aspects, it is there. Or we can call it silicon age, or the importance of the electric cars and other activities, the batteries, probably lithium will become a very, very important material. And in case of civil engineering also, like different periods of time, new materials emerged, revolutionizing the construction practices, in terms of structurals, we have steel, RCC, precious concrete, then other materials also. So today I am talking about one type of material, which is called geosynthetics. It is mostly, it will be used within the ground. So we may not see it most of the time, but it is working behind the scenes. So the definition of geosynthetics, it is a little complicated. The geo is related to the earth or soil. So materials which are used in contact with soil, that is clear. Synthetic, sometimes it is understood as being polymeric, because some of the definitions also say polymeric materials. There is another interpretation which says synthesized. So any material which is synthesized can be called a synthetic, because nowadays we sometimes call coir geotextiles, jute geotextiles, which are natural materials like that. But still, if we apply the term synthesized, it can be, there is nothing wrong in calling that also. So in that sense, even if it is steel, if it is used within the soil, can be considered as a geosynthetic like that. So these are all splitting hairs, we need not be too much concerned about that. And coming to the products, there are a vast variety of products, because initially everything used to be called geotextiles or geofabrics like that. Then different products getting developed, different names came into existence. See, all these are different types of, there are even more other products also like that. Then depending on their properties, the mechanical properties, hydraulic properties, etc., they can perform various functions. So again, these are different functions like that. We may be familiar with many of them. We have heard in other contexts also. So here in today's lecture, we are focusing on two functions. One is stabilization and reinforcement. Both are closely related like that. So see, not all type of geosynthetics can be used for these functions. So because it is related to reinforcement or stabilization, the mechanical properties are important, tensile strength, stiffness, which are more important actually. So these highlight the geogrids, geotextiles, geocomposites, geocells, geomats. So these are the products which we'll be covering today, which are used for stabilization and reinforcement. So this is the International Geosynthetic Society has a definition of reinforcement and stabilization. The reinforcement, we are very familiar, because we are all familiar with the reinforced concrete, because using steel reinforcement, we are improving the property of concrete, because concrete is weak in tension. So by including a reinforcement, in a similar way, we know the soils are weak in tension. So by including a reinforcement, we can strengthen the soils like that. We can make it stronger, we can make it stiffer, we can make it an angle much steeper like that. So the stabilization, the term has come recently like that. This is the improvement of a mechanical behavior of an unbound granular material, like a granular subbase or a granular base of the roads, or the blanket or ballast of a railway track. These are all unbound, which means the granular material is not bound by any cementing material like cement or bitumen like that. So when it is reinforced, or when you introduce a geosynthetic into this layer, we stabilize it. So the layer becomes stronger, stiffer. And the main objective is to minimize the deformation of the unbound granular material. So slight difference, like earlier, the stabilization was introduced recently, not earlier. We used to call it reinforcement. So probably to give a slight difference between the emphasis, probably here it is more related to strength, whereas here it is more related to stiffness like that. But they are very closely related applications. So geosynthetics are used in different applications. See, one is reinforced soil, walls and slopes, actually, because we know like a earthen embankment can, it may be stable at a slope of say 30 degree or 32 degree like that. See, as long as the inclination becomes more than the angle of shearing resistance of the soil, it may fail like that. But by introducing soil reinforcement, we can make it at standard steeper angles. So this is the basic idea in reinforced soil walls and slopes. Then reinforced soil foundations, like suppose we want to construct an embankment on a poor soil, like weak clay or silt, or even a footing or a foundation on a weak soil, we have the problem of bearing capacity and settlement like that. So one possible technique is, if we can reinforce the soils below the foundation, we can increase the bearing capacity as well as reduce the settlement like that. Then, as I mentioned earlier, like in the case of roads, so whether highway pavements, airport pavements, or railway tracks, we use the granular base or subbase in the case of pavements, or the ballast or the subblast or blanket in the case of railway track, to support the tracks. Actually, by introducing the reinforcement, we can stabilize or reinforce these materials. So here the main objective is to reduce deformations, because we know like a road or a railway track, it doesn't fail by a single application of the load, because the applied loads are much less compared to the sort of a bearing capacity. But when but the number of load repetitions could be very large. Actually, in the case of a road, it could be several millions of repetitions of axle loads. So each time a load is supplied, a small deformation is occur. So again, incremental deformation like that. So over a period of time, because of the accumulated deformations, the pavement or the railway track fails, actually. So here, the objective of the reinforcement or stabilization is mainly to control the deformations. Then we will talk about asphalt reinforcement. The bituminous concrete layer in the pavement, flexible pavements, can be reinforced. We can also reinforce concrete. This is not as a structural reinforcement, but what we call secondary reinforcement to prevent cracking due to shrinkage stresses or temperature, etc. We can use geosynthetics or secondary reinforcement. So here the main purpose is to control cracking, actually, because the tensile stresses induce cracking. By reinforcing it, we can control the cracking. And I will also briefly talk about another application called reinforced vegetation. So here we know, like the water, when the rainwater flows over the ground surface or a slope, or the river banks or stream banks exposed to flowing currents or waves, the soil particles get eroded. So growing vegetation is one of the means of controlling this erosion. So the performance of vegetation can be enhanced by certain type of geosynthetics, which are known as erosion control blankets or mats. So here the main objective is to control erosion or to hold the soil particles in place. So first, let's start with the reinforced soil walls and slopes. So here I have drawn, like, there is a like a mass of soil with a vertical face. So from experience, we know that it will not stand, like if it is a rock or concrete, it will be stable but a soil, because soils have very little cohesion, like it will not be stable. So if we analyze the equilibrium, I have drawn this wedge, unstable wedge, and drawn the forces acting on that. So if you try to do that exercise, we will know that the force polygon will not close. That means the wedges will not be in equilibrium. There is a net unbalanced force, which we call the active earth pressure. See, now if you want to keep this wedge in equilibrium or the vertical face in equilibrium, we have to apply an equal and opposite force to hold this in equilibrium. So this can be done in different ways. Like, this is the basic concept of earth retention. Like, see, one option is we construct a mass gravity retaining wall, like out of plain cement concrete or masonry or gabions, etc. So here the active zone applies a force, actually active earth pressure on the wall. And the wall, if it is designed properly, it will apply an equal and opposite reaction, keeping the soil mass in equilibrium like that. Since the force is applied from the outside, normally we call this an externally stabilized system. So we construct the retaining wall. Now, the only problem, the material is more expensive. Like, if it is stone masonry or concrete, or even if it is gabion, the material is expensive. And here in this case, the wall resists the applied earth pressure by its own weight, actually. That's why we call it mass gravity. And the wall has to be proportioned in such a way that no tension will develop anywhere in the structure, because it is constructed of masonry or plain cement concrete, which cannot resist tension, actually. So we need a massive wall like that. Becomes expensive. So for 3-4 meters, say up to 5 meters, maybe it is okay. But beyond that, it becomes uneconomical. So we have to think how we can develop much more economical systems. And the key in economy is reducing the quantity of expensive materials. So one option we can think of is using an RCC retaining wall like that. So here, this red dotted line I've shown was the outline of the mass gravity wall. So in the case of RCC cantilever wall, it will have almost the same width, actually, but it will have a much thinner stem and a base slab, actually. So the idea is the weight of soil, the mass of soil, which is resting on this base slab, see, that plus the RCC wall acts together in resisting the applied earth pressure from here, like that. So it retains this soil. But now the only problem is, because the stem is very thin, tension will be introduced, actually. So we have to introduce steel reinforcements. So the steel reinforcement is more, but then we have reduced the volume of concrete substantially. So overall, it becomes economical. So this system may be economical up to, say, 6, 7, 8 meters. Beyond that, we can think of counterfort like that. But how can I reduce even further the volume of concrete, actually? So there we go to the concept of reinforceable structures. So the red dotted line is the outline of the RCC wall. So if I can think of taking out the entire base slab, like we remove the entire base slab, then we reduce the thickness of the stem, like substantially like that. So this may be, which may be, it could be up to, say, 1 meter thick here, in the case of RCC cantilever. So we reduce it to, say, around, say, 15 or 20 centimeters, a thin facing only. See, now we know this will not be stable, actually. So we have two challenges. Like, one is we should have a stable block, which will have sufficient mass, which will resist the applied earth pressures, actually. Secondly, the mass itself has to be internally stable, actually, like that. So because earlier the RCC stem was holding this place, but now the stem is much thinner, so it has very little structural strength. So I have to introduce sort of reinforcements. But if you can introduce horizontal layers of number of layers of reinforcements, say geosynthetics, then I stabilize this unstable wedge, and the block as a whole is stable now. So by its weight, it's able to resist the applied earth pressures. So in the system, we are actually stabilizing this mass internally. Like, so we also call it internally stabilized system. Right? So again, if we come back to the equilibrium of this wedge, like, we introduce several reinforcements like that. So the wedge is trying to move outward, downward. So in that process, it will develop tension in the reinforcement. So if we add up all the tensions together, it should be equal to the active earth pressure, which is the unbalanced force. So as long as we supply sufficient reinforcement, this will be in stable like that. So what you have done, like we have like removed the costly material, like we have only a very thin facing at this at the external, which is called the facing. Otherwise, the retaining wall is constructed mostly of soil with some reinforcement, which is the geosynthetic material like that. So similar concepts are like we have anchored or soil nail. So we will not go into that. So some of the reinforced soil, like you may have seen in Surat also, I'm sure you'll have lot, you'll see a lot of these structures. So mostly we will be seeing this concrete blocks or panels outside, but actually what is holding the earth in place is this geosynthetics, which are inside actually like that. Then what is the difference between a reinforced soil wall and a slope? The concept is very similar. Like we introduce reinforcement. The main difference is the inclination. Like if the face inclination is steeper than 70 degrees to the horizontal, we call it a wall. And if it is less than 70 degrees, we call it a slope actually. So 70 degrees is a convenient figure, nothing sacrosanct, but most of the codes have decided this is a convenient figure. So if it is steeper than 70 degrees, we design it as a retaining wall. That means using a pressure theory. And if it is less than 70 degrees, we design it as a slope using a slope stability approach. So like this shows like a reinforced slope with a like a wraparound facing using a soil fill bag. So it is not necessary that we should have a concrete facing with blocks or panels, etc. We can have this type of facings, which can be vegetated. We can have gabions. We can have geocells. So many types of options are there, actually. So a good example of a steep slope, actually. Like this is for a hill road, actually. So in the absence of reinforced soil, like imagine like this is something like 40 meter high. So the base width required would have been around 80 meters. That means normally like a two horizontal, one vertical slope is safe. So to have a retain a height of 80 meter, we need a base width of 80 meters. So much land has to be acquired. Another problem is nowadays we know the cost of soil, getting soil for construction is becoming a problem like in many states like that. So with this steep slopes, we are able to reduce the land acquisition as well as reduce the volume of soil also like that. So these are the fill retention options. Like whenever if you have to retain fill, we can go for a conventional retaining wall. We can go for a reinforced soil retaining wall, or we can go for a reinforced soil slope actually. So each has its own advantages, limitations, but normally we can take it for certain that as the height increases, these systems will become more and more economical like that. So, and one important difference between reinforced soil walls and slopes is that for this, we need a good quality granular fill actually, like a soil in which the silt and clay, that is the fines are less than about 15%. Whereas in the case of slopes, we can go up to say 50% fines. So we can use locally available materials like that. But this needs more space actually. When you go for a slope, it needs more space. But if there is absolutely no space available like that, we'll have to go for a wall up to the full height like that. So each site will have its own advantages, limitations. So we have to evaluate all the options. Then what is best suited for the site, we have to select. So the technology, what gives us is it gives us more options like that. So sometimes it is like a hybrid, like it may not, the bottom portion is something like a wall, whereas the towards the top, it's more like a slopes like that. So this is a like one of the tallest structures in India in the Sikkim port, Sikkim airport, which is about, I think, 75 meters high. It is designed and constructed by a company called McCaffrey. Another application of reinforcement is secondary. Like sometimes what happens, we construct embankments, like this is a two horizontal, one vertical slope. We can see a lot of these structures for highways, railways, etc. So like near the face, actually, the soil will not get compacted actually like that, because when the roller, see, soil gets compacted when it is confined. Because when we do the compaction test, we do it in a container like that. Soil is confined within the container. So when we do the hammer, like we using the hammer, we try to compact it, it gets compacted. But if the soil is not confined, it will not get compacted actually. So within here, interiorly, here the soil here is being confined by the soil on this side. So it will get compacted. But near the surface, like when you run the roller, the soil will move laterally, like it becomes difficult to compact. So one technique which is usually done is you place an extra width, like suppose you place additional, say, half a meter of soil, you compact it. After that, you'd have to trim it back like that. But sometimes it is specified, but rarely done at the site. An alternative is we can introduce short lengths of reinforcement, say like something like 1.2 to 2 meter. At say 0.3 to 0.5 meter spacing. So this will give sort of confinement here, and it will facilitate better compaction like that. Then it can be used for reinstatement of fail slopes like that. Then another group of applications is reinforced soil foundations. So here the main issues are like the foundation stability, like global failure, bearing capacity failure, etc. So one, like whenever we have to construct an embankment, either for a highways or railways, or even flood protection embankments or dikes, etc., on a soft foundation like clay and silt, there is a problem. Like, so there could be lateral spreading, there could be a bearing capacity failure, there could be a deep-seated rotational failure, different types of failures. So one technique which we use is geosynthetic reinforcement, because at the base of the embankment, that means on the existing ground surface, we put a geosynthetic reinforcement across the full width of the embankment, then construct the embankment actually. So this sorts of prevents like different types of failures like that. So in many cases, this could be an option like that. So if this works, this is going to be the most convenient and cheapest option, one of the cheapest options. But then it has many limitations also like that. Or sometimes like it doesn't reduce settlement much like that. So it is not that everywhere this is an option, but in some cases, this could be an option like that. Basal reinforcement. Another is a basal mattress. Like this again, it is like we can see at the bottom horizontally, there will be like a geogrid or a geotextile. Then vertically, this geogrid layers like that. Then transverse in a zigzag portion, this geogrids are placed like that. So this will be something like a 1 meter thick mattress type of fill. Then this will be filled with granular material and compacted like that. So this forms like a flexible raft at the base of the embankment. Then if the basal reinforcement or mattress will not work like that, then we may have to go for other techniques like a stone columns. Like, you know, for ground improvement, stone columns is a very popular option. But if the clay is very soft, see, how do stone columns work actually? Because the stone has to be confined by the soil actually, like that. Because if you imagine, like, if the soil is very, it has no, absolutely no shear strength, the stone column will not work. Then we may have to go for concrete piles. If you use concrete piles, okay, it can transfer the embankment load to the foundation, to a strong foundation. But if it is made of stones, if there is no confinement, the stones, the stone column itself will bulge out and fail actually. So in the case of very soft clays, if the N value is less than say 1, 2, or 3 like that, then one option is sort of a geosynthetic encased stone columns actually. So the stone is encased within a circular sleeve like that. So when the stones try to bulge out, this is being confined by the encasement actually, like that. So even in soft clays, stone column can be constructed. So this shows the concept actually, like, so it is a like a circular sleeve or a flexible casing made of geotextile. So like this will be inserted and it'll be filled with stone. So when the loads are applied, the stones try to bulge out, but this is being confined by the encasement like that. Another application is like when we may have like a stone column or even concrete piles, but it will be provided a spacing like that. So we should need something like a pile cap to transfer the embankment load to these vertical elements like that. So a geosynthetic reinforced load transfer platform is mainly used. So this will be a layer of granular material, maybe half a meter or 1 meter thick, reinforced with several layers of reinforcements. Like, so this is called a load transfer platform. It is similar to a pile cap, we can say. Shows the load transfer platform like that. There could be several layers depending on the design. That means depending on the spacing of the columns, the thickness and the number of layers will vary like that. So this, through sort of an arching action, it will transfer the loads to the piles and will ensure that the weak soil in between the columns are not loaded. Again, another application is below the footings. Like if you have a isolated footing, like a strip footing or a isolated footing, like we have this surface. So if we introduce reinforcement below the foundation, it will intersect the bearing capacity surface and it will increase the ultimate bearing capacity like that. And a very popular topic for research, like even now a lot of people study like model studies and analytical studies like that. But practically, compared to the other applications like reinforced soil walls or slopes or embankment foundations, this has not, I can't say that this is that common, this application, but sometimes it is being used. Then supportive bridge approach slabs, like we can see, like this is like a bridge which is being supported on piles. Then there is an approach embankment actually. So the piles may be resting on a hard stratum. So the bridge as such will undergo very negligible settlement. But if the embankment is resting on a compressible foundation like a clay or silt, it will undergo large settlements like that. So there will be a level difference actually. Like when a vehicle comes, there will be a bump like that. So to avoid that problem, we give an approach slab like that, plus a like a strip footing here. So when the embankment settles, the approach slab, this end will settle along with the embankment like that. But this point will rest on here like that. So it provides sort of a smooth transition from the embankment to the. So here also to reinforce, we can use the reinforcements actually. It will increase the bearing capacity of this region. So we have also known as what are geosynthetic reinforced soil bridge abutments. So here, see, normally the reinforced soil has to support only air pressure like that. But here this is an abutment. So it has to support the active earth pressures. In addition, it has to support the bridge deck because this is also resting directly on the soil. So to increase the bearing capacity here, we introduce like reinforcements actually in this zone. This is also sort of a foundation reinforcement. Like, now this system is becoming very popular in the US actually. In India, we have like a few true abutments, but still I would say this is rare, like, but slowly catching on. Then another major application is the reinforcement or stabilization of unbound aggregates. So unbound aggregates means granular material which is not bound by any cementing material like cement or bitumen like that. So the examples are the granular subbase, the granular base, the ballast, subballast, etc. like that. So the basic idea is this, like in the case there is a like a wheel load. It applies depending on the there is a like a bituminous layer, then there is a base layer. So it spreads the load to the subgrade actually. Then with each repetition, there will be an additional incremental like that. So over a period of time, there will be rutting in the subgrade and it may fail like that. So if we introduce a reinforcement, what happens? It increases the strength and stiffness of this layer. So the stresses are dispersed over a larger area like that. So the stresses in the subgrade could be reduced actually like that. So either the life of the pavement could be increased or we can reduce the thickness of the base course or the structural thickness of the pavement could be reduced. Both ways we can use it. Now, how does the base reinforcement improves the performance? Basically, there are three mechanisms. So first is the lateral restraint, or sometimes what we call the shear resisting interface. So the wheel loads apply the vertical stresses, which causes the granular material to deform laterally like that. The vertical stresses induce lateral deformations in the granular material. So here, when the granular material tends to deform laterally, the shear stresses are introduced at the interface between the reinforcement, between the geosynthetic reinforcement and the granular material. So it offers what is known as a lateral restraint, actually. So again, it involves a number of mechanisms, like because of this lateral shear stresses, the lateral spreading of the aggregate is reduced. So the lateral deformation reduced means even vertical deformation will be reduced. Then the shear stresses gives confinement to these aggregates. So any soil or granular material, when it is confined, it is stronger and stiffer, actually. So because of this confinement, the stiffness of this material improves. So it is able to, because this is stronger and stiffer, it is able to distribute the load over a wide area. So the vertical stresses in the subgrade will reduce. So naturally, the strains in the subgrade also will be reduced. Another is it will even reduce the shear stresses on the subgrade legs. So when the aggregate tends to spread laterally, it will introduce shear stresses in the subgrade. But because of the geosynthetic, even that is reduced, actually. This is one of the most important mechanisms how the geosynthetic reinforcement improves the performance of unbound aggregates. Another mechanism is the bearing capacity increase. Like if there was no geosynthetic, because normally the subgrade is the weakest element here. So the bearing capacity failure will extend into the subgrade like that. But when you put a reinforcement here, it will intersect the bearing capacity failure. So if at all bearing capacity failure, it will happen here, which is in the stronger material. So that means the bearing capacity will increase. Another is the tension membrane effect. When you apply a load here, it will undergo a deformation. So this is like a tension membrane like that. So the upward component of the tension will directly support the wheel load. Here also, like there is a, like the curvature varies. So here, the downward component of the, this will confine the soil here, actually. So both ways there is benefit, but this mechanism can develop only if there is substantial rutting of the pavement can take place. So for a unpaved road, this is okay. We can depend on that. But for a flexible pavement with a bituminous surfacing, this mechanism cannot be dependent upon because we cannot allow so much deformation in the pavement. Similar concept is rail track bed stabilization. So like below the sleeper, we have the ballast, and below the ballast, we'll have a sub-ballast or a blanket like that, then the subgrade actually. So we can put a geosynthetic at the bottom of the sub-ballast or within the ballast or at the bottom of the ballast like that. So like again, we can use it in the construction of new lines as well as for the rehabilitation of the existing lines, because the running tracks, they have the problem. See, over a period of time, there is the fouling of the ballast. It has settled actually. So they have to renew the track actually. So one option is we can remove the ballast, put a geosynthetic reinforcement here, then clean the ballast and replace it like that. Or in the case of new construction also, we can do this. So again, the concept is we can either increase in the design life or we can reduce the thickness of the sub-ballast or the ballast. Both ways, it is possible. Nowadays, in many countries, they have the system of highly mechanized track renewal. So this is like a long machine. So initially what it is, it lifts the track at a particular, for a particular stretch, it will lift the track actually. Then remove all the fouled ballast like that. So again, it will be washed and screened. If fresh material has to be, it will be added. Then a geosynthetic will be laid like that. So again, the ballast will be put and tamped like that. So it will go on completely mechanized and automated process. So some various the the foundation reinforcement and the slope and retaining wall applications. So see, now let us look at the different kinds of geosynthetics. So broadly, we classify into two groups. One is uniaxial geosynthetics, which means it has approximately this, it has actually the tensile strength predominantly in one direction, actually, which is normally the longitudinal direction. Whereas in the other direction, there is only a minimum strength like that. So these are applied when there are structures where the force to be resisted is predominantly in one direction, like structures which are very long, like a reinforced soil wall. A retaining wall is long. Similarly, a reinforced soil slope or even embankment. So these are what we call sort of a, there is a plane strain conditions, actually. The structure is long. So the force, the disturbing force is perpendicular to the length direction. Like, see, normally in the case of retaining wall, the active earth pressure is perpendicular to the retaining wall, actually. Whereas in the along the retaining wall, there is no net unbalanced force, actually. So in these cases, we need a geosynthetic, which is stronger in one direction. Whereas in the other direction, we don't need much strength like that. So like in the case of reinforced soil walls and slopes, these are the different types, like high density polyethylene, punched and extruded geogrids. These are different manufacturing process. Then there is a knitted or woven and coated geogrids, which are made of mostly polyester. Then there are polymeric strips, which are mostly used for walls. Then woven polyester or polypropylene geotextiles. Then there are reinforced non-woven composites, actually. In the case of basal reinforced embankments, we can go for high strength geogrids or high strength woven polyester geotextile. See, normally here, we need much more higher strength compared to the reinforced soil wall or slopes. So either it will be a very high strength geogrids or high strength woven polyester geotextiles. So we look at this, how do they look like? So this is one of the first type of geogrid to come out. It was invented by the company called Tensar, Netlon and Tensar in the UK. So actually the base material is like a high density polyethylene sheet. In that you punch holes like that at a regular pattern. Then under heat and pressure, we stretch this actually. So what you see in essence, this elongated ellipse was originally a circular hole actually, because when this was stretched, it got elongated. And during the stretching process, the polymer chains get oriented, actually. It becomes stronger and stiffer like that. So the longitudinal ribs and transverse ribs, these are monolithic, actually. So because if you recall, originally it was a solid sheet. From that only, this geogrid has been created. Like. So the tensile strength in the range of 40 to 160 kilonewton per meter. See, because of this process, we can go for very high strengths, actually. And elongation may be around 11%, plus or minus 3%, like that. So, and another advantage of HDP is from the chemical resistance point of view, this is one of the most durable materials like that. It is resistant to almost all type of acids and alkalis like that. So it can be, we can embed it into concrete or fly ash or any type of material, usually there is no problem. Like another type is what is known as woven or knitted and coated polyester grids. So these are also called flexible grids or even textile grids like that. So here the manufacturing process is either weaving or knitting actually. So it consists of high tenacity polyester filament yarns actually. See each, there will be bundles, this filament yarns are very fine, very, very small diameter filaments. Then it will be put into bundles and they are woven like that. So the warp and the weft like that, it is woven. Then it will be coated with a PVC or any other material like that. So in the case of knitting, similar process. So instead of weaving like that, so this longitudinal bundle of yarn, then transverse bundle of yarn. So there is a knitting yarn which goes and bonds this together like that. So the process is knitting, and again it has to be coated like that. So the manufacturing process is somewhat different, otherwise properties are more or less same like that. So here the strength, here we can go to much higher strengths, even up to 400 kilonewton per meter like that. We can go even higher, but then problem is, as we have more and more yarn, then we will not be left with any aperture like that, because geogrids, by definition, at least 50% has to be open, like aperture area has to be there like that. Then elongation, something like 10 to 15%. Another technique is what is known as laid or welded geogrid. So here, this can be, in the case of uniaxial, it will be mostly polyester. So this is a bar or strip of polyester, like it. So it is put in two directions, and the junction is welded by maybe with a laser or ultrasonic process, it will be welded. So here it will be fused together like that. So again, the strength could be from 40 to 400 kilonewton per meter. Only here, compared to other grids, it has a lower elongation actually. So that means the tensile modulus will be higher. Another product is a strap, which we call polymeric strap or geo strip. So this will be something like our car seat belt. Again, this is made of polyester, like these the bundles of polyester filament yarn, high density filament yarn. So then surrounding that, it is a polyethylene sheath actually, like that. So instead of the coating, this is more of a sheath kind of thing, like that. But it is very narrow. It is normally the geogrids is made in a width of say 4 meter or 5 meter wide rolls, but here these are strips actually, 85 to 100 millimeter width only. Then tensile strength, something like 30 kilonewton to 100 kilonewton. Because this is a strip, we express in terms of kilonewton, whereas for the geogrid, we express the strength in terms of kilonewton per meter. Elongation also something like 10 to 12%. So these are commonly used for reinforced soil retaining walls like that. Then if we combine these strips together, we can create very high tensile strength reinforcements. So there is a, like again, the company called McCaffrey, they produce this very high strength geogrids. Basically, these strips which are bonded together like that, there will be a transverse elements also like that. But predominant strength is in this direction. And we can see it can go up to 1,600 kilonewton per meter. Really, really very high strengths like that. Then we can have woven polypropylene geotextiles, because for reinforcement, we need relatively good tensile strength and stiffness. So we cannot use non-woven, because non-wovens are, the tensile strength is low. Similarly, the elongation is very high. Normally, the elongation is even more than 50%. So for reinforcement applications, we prefer woven geotextiles. So we can use woven polypropylene, this type of small tapes like that, filament yarns. Again, like 30 to 300 kilonewton meter products are available. Like different companies have different product range like that. So this can be used for reinforced soil walls, slopes, etc. Then woven polyester geotextiles. So here, again, made of polyester filament yarn. This is woven, like woven in the warp and weft directions. And we can see this sort of interlacing actually. The warp and weft goes up and down like that. So this is the weaving pattern. There'll be different weaving pattern. So here we can go for very high strengths up to 1,200 kilonewton per meter like that. Like, see, most of these products, again, I forgot to mention, all these products are today manufactured in India. Like the strips, woven geotextiles, polyester grids, most of the products are manufactured in India like that. So there was a time when we used to import, like, because I started working in this field in 1997 when I joined a company called Netlon. See, at that time, most of these products we used to import actually. But now over the last, say, 15, 20 years or so, like so many companies have come up in India, like manufacturing this product. So I am associated with one company, which is TechFab India Industries. So they have their factories in like Silvassa and Daman, like where they manufacture all these kinds of products like geogrids, geostrips, geotextiles, like even this type of products also, they manufacture up to 1,200 kilonewton per meter strength. Another type is knitted polyester geotextile. So this is, I think it was first developed a company called the Tensar company, like they call it base text actually. Again, it can go up to very high tensile strengths, up to, they make up to 1000 kilonewton per meter. Another interesting product is a what is called a reinforced non-woven composite geotextile. So there is a, at the base, we can see a non-woven geotextile like that. Then which is reinforced with high tenacity polyester filament yarns in both directions like that. So if you want a uniaxial, we can have strength, more strength in this direction. We can put more polyester yarn in this direction. But if you want biaxial, we put equal strength in both directions like that. So here the idea is the high tenacity polyester filament yarns, it gives the strength and stiffness, whereas the non-woven component can use serve as a good filter and separator like that. So it combines multiple functions like filtration, drainage, separation, and reinforcement like that. Again, this like TechFab India is manufacturing this product. And one of the landmark structures in India, like this season in Vijayawada in Andhra Pradesh, this was something like a 40 meter high retaining wall. Like it's not a single tire actually, it is in steps, like 10 meter, some setback, another 10 meter, some setback like that. So this, they had used this type of product actually, this reinforced non-woven, but it was imported, like it was from a company like Polyfelt, like a composite geotextile. And why did they use this material? Because they used a film material with relatively more fines actually. So when there are more fines in the soil, it may develop, it, when it gets saturated, it may develop pore pressures. So it was felt, this type of material, it can act, it can help to release the pore pressures actually, because the water can be dissipated through this non-woven component like that. So the designer felt this would have been a more appropriate product and he used this type of material. Like. Then coming to the design parameters for uniaxial soil reinforcement. So the important properties are four. Like one is the long-term design strength, which is the tensile strength. Then the coefficient of interaction, indirect sliding and pull out. So like same way, like in the concrete reinforcement, the reinforcement should have good tensile strength and it should have a good bond with the concrete. Same way, soil reinforcement also, it should have good tensile strength and stiffness. At the same time, it should have developed good bond with the soil. Like then only it will be effective as a reinforcement. Then for the reinforced soil structures, we need a facing. So the reinforcement has to be connected with the facing. So it should develop good connection strength also with the reinforcement. So like just to illustrate the concept only, like when we design a reinforced soil structure, first we'll calculate each layer, what is the tension coming in the reinforcement, which is a very simple calculation. Like at any level, if we can calculate the vertical stress. Then if you multiply the vertical stress by a coefficient of earth pressure, we will get the horizontal stress at that level. Then we assume this reinforcement resists the horizontal stresses in this zone, like that. So we can calculate the tension. So we calculate the tension in the reinforcement at level. Then the design criteria is the tension should be less than the long-term design strength divided by a factor safety, where TD is the long-term design strength. Now, the long-term design strength is defined as the ultimate tensile strength, which we measure from a short-term tensile test, like divided by a number of reduction factors for creep, then for insulation damage, for durability, weathering, then there is a factor safety for extrapolation actually, like that. See, now we know the polymers are viscoelastic. That means if we apply a load and maintain it, the deformations will continue to increase with time, actually. So here we have time on the x-axis, strain in the y-axis. So that means if we apply a load, there is an immediate strain. Then with time, it will continue to increase, actually. So if you increase the load, this will go on increasing actually. So if you apply higher load, it will undergo creep rupture like that. So like when we design a reinforced soil structure, the design life could be 50 years, 100 years, like that. So the tension in the reinforcement will act for a long time. So that means with time, there will be creep deformations. And if this the applied stresses are sufficiently high, it may undergo rupture after some time. So we have to ensure that creep rupture will not occur during the design life. So for that, we do the creep characterization. So we generate the creep rupture curve. So here in the x-axis, it shows time in log scale, time in hours in log scale. And the y-axis is the rupture strength as a percentage of the ultimate tensile strength. So that means, so I can explain it like this. Suppose a geosynthetic, it has a strength of say 100 kilonewton. And if I take a geosynthetic and apply 100 kilonewton instantaneously, it will break instantaneously, rupture like that. So immediate failure like that. But suppose I apply a load of 90 kilonewton. So that means the applied load as a percentage of the ultimate tensile strength is 90%. So it may rupture as a after a few minutes like that. So but if I apply 80% of the tensile strength, the rupture again will take after some time like that. So if I do a series of tests actually, then I can generate this curve actually. So the problem is the design life is something like 100 years, but we cannot do a test of 100 years duration. So we have means of accelerating it. That means if I test at higher temperature, the creep can be accelerated like that. So in this curve, there are this pink squares, this shows like conventional rupture. So these are conventional creep tests like that. Say, see, 3 means it is 1000 hours. Similarly, here 4 means up to 10,000 hours, almost say 450 days, we do the conventional test in the initial portion. Then the others, like these are what are known as tipped isothermal, that means accelerated creep test done at a higher temperature like that. So if both fall on the same trend like that, so then we can guarantee that the extrapolation is valid like that. So here we can see that the conventional creep test as well as the accelerated creep test, they fall on the same trend line. Then they do a statistical analysis from that like that. So now my design life say is something like 100 years. So this is 10 raised to 6 hours, which is 114 years, which means this gives 70% actually. So that means if my applied stresses are less than 70% of the ultimate tensile strength, then the creep rupture will not occur within the design life like that. So from that, I can determine my creep reduction factor. So here in this case, my creep reduction factor will be 1 divided by 0.7. So each type of material like HDPE, polyester will have its own different behavior. So the manufacturer does this test and they will provide this data to the designers. See, another problem is insulation damage because the reinforcement is put in the soil actually. So a layer of soil is compacted, the reinforcement is put, next layer of fill is put, then it will be compacted by heavy rollers like that. In that process, it may undergo some damage, some abrasion, some cuts like that. So in design, we have to determine what is the strength loss actually. Excuse me for a minute. So what is the strength lost during insulation? So this is determined using the insulation damage testing, which simulates the actual construction actually. So there are a lot of variables actually, the type of fill material, like whether it is coarse angular material or is it is sand like that, then the layer thickness, then the weight of roller, etc. All this will have its influence actually. So based on that, we simulate that actually. We put a layer of soil compacted, put a layer of geosynthetic, put next layer of soil compacted, then remove, we compact it like that. then we remove the material, then we remove the geogrid actually, like that, taking care like that. Then do the tensile test. So earlier, the undamaged specimen, we would have determined the tensile strength. Then after this damaged specimen also, we determine the tensile strength. Then the tensile strength of the virgin or undamaged product divided by the tensile strength of the damaged product, that becomes our insulation damage. So again, the manufacturer, he performs this test for a range of different types of fill materials and for the different products, and they will give this reduction factors. Then for durability, the reinforcement is sitting in the soil for say 10 years, 50 years, 100 years. So it will be acted upon by the various chemicals, the different types of bacteria in the soil. And again, we can expect some strength loss. So how much is it? So there are two approaches. So one is what is known as default reduction factor. So based on some index properties, the type of raw material. So if it is the polyester geogrid, we have two important parameters, the molecular weight and something known as carboxyl end groups. So this is related to the polyester chemistry like that. So depending on that, we can use some default reduction factors. Again, this damage will depend on the temperature, then whether the soil is alkaline, is it acidic like that? So there are tables, like there are some standards in which, so if temperature is in this range and pH is in this range for this type of material, we can use a reduction factor, say 1.1, 1.2, 1.3 like that. So this can be used. But if you want something more accurate like that, then the product specific long-term chemical test has to be done. So in this, people do, they'll prepare different types of solutions, like different pH, like acids, alkalis. Then put the geosynthetic strips into this solution. And again, here time is a problem actually. So we tested higher temperatures actually, like 40 degree, 50 degree, 60 degree, 70 degree like that. Then determine the strength loss period of time, do after 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, 2 year like that. Then using this Arrhenius equation, we can extrapolate and determine what is the strength loss at the room temperature like that, at 20 degree or 30 degree, from reduction factors. Then for weathering, actually weathering means exposed to the atmosphere. Like we know, like normally most of the plastics, they don't degrade, like that is a problem actually. Like they are not biodegradable, but plastics have one enemy, which is the sunlight, or more specifically the ultraviolet component of solar radiation. So most plastics will degrade when exposed to sunlight actually. So to prevent that, the manufacturers will add what are known as UV stabilizers like that. So depending on the thickness, if it is something like a solid sheet, it will have more UV resistance, but if it is a fine fiber, it may degrade faster like that. So like a geotextile may degrade faster compared to a geogrid. Similarly, if the geogrid is not coated, like if a geogrid is coated, it'll have more UV resistance. Then people also add different types of UV stabilizers like that. So depending on the different type of products, like we sort of allow what is the permissible exposure time. So most manufacturers will recommend like the product should not be exposed to sunlight for more than time. But if it is, so normally, if it is covered within a day, like that means the roll, you remove the wrapping, then you cut it into pieces, then you install, place the soil, compact it. So the geogrid is covered by soil within a day, there is no problem. Then the reduction factor can be one like that. But if it is exposed to more duration, then a reduction factor for weathering may have to be applied like that. Then that was about the long-term tensile strength. Then second aspect is the pullout actually. So here, let us come back to this, our retaining wall like that. Earlier, we mentioned that at this point, it develops a tension actually. We had calculated the tension. So in the long-term design strength, we ensure that the reinforcement will not rupture. It will not break like that. It has sufficient tensile strength. Another way it can fail is it can pull out actually. Like, so if the anchorage length or the bond length is less, it will pull out actually. So the geosynthetic has to resist the tension by having adequate tensile strength, and it has to resist pullout by having adequate bond length, actually. So again, this resistance we can calculate like this. Two, because the geosynthetics bottom surface, top surface, into the anchorage length, which is LE. That means the length beyond the failure plane, that is the anchorage length, into the coefficient of friction, coefficient of interface friction, into the vertical stress, actually. See, now in soil mechanics, it's a practice. The coefficient of friction can be related to the angle of internal friction of the soil. So if phi is the angle of internal friction of the soil, then a coefficient of interface friction called CI into tan phi, that will give you the coefficient of interface friction. Now, to determine CI, we can do a pullout test, actually. So here there is a box. So there is a layer of soil. Then we put the geosynthetic, put one more layer of soil, compact it at required density, then apply a normal stress. Then you try to pull this out. Then you pull this out. So we measure what is the maximum pullout force. And from that, we can determine the coefficient of interaction for sliding. Again, it will vary depending on the type of geosynthetic and the type of soil. It will vary. You can do it in the laboratory. There is laboratory pullout test. This shows an equipment, actually, like that. This is the box is here. You put this loading plate. We can apply the normal stresses. And by this pulling mechanism, we can pull it out. There is an ASTM standard for that. Even IS standard is also there, I believe. Sometimes people even feel the pullout test can be conducted, like within the facing, we can leave a hole. We can put an extra layer of geosynthetic here. Then you try to pull it out. And from that, we can measure the interface friction coefficient. Another failure is what is known as internal sliding. So if you remember, this is made of reinforced soil. So in principle, the sliding can take place at any level, And the weakest plane is the interface between the reinforcement and the soil, actually. So we have to check whether the sliding failure takes place. So normally, the calculation is done like this, actually. At any level, we determine what is the total horizontal force due to the pressure to the weight of fill as well as surcharge. Then the factor safety of sliding is what is the total normal force into a coefficient of interface friction in sliding divided by the resultant active air pressure. And the interface friction in direct sliding is also related to the internal friction angle of the soil. We call it CDS, coefficient of interface friction tan phi. So just like the coefficient of interaction in pullout was determined through a pullout test, this is a modified direct shear test. The same test, direct shear test, which we determine the friction angle of the soil. So here we can have at the bottom, we can put a block or we can put soil. Then that the interface, that in the direct shear box, there are two split boxes. At the interface, we put the geosynthetic, put soil, apply a normal first, and you shear it, actually. So in the pullout, the geosynthetic was pulled out from the soil. In the case of sliding, a block of soil is sliding over the geosynthetic. That is the difference, actually. So from this, again, we can determine the these type of equipment are available. We can determine the coefficient of this friction. Another important parameter is the connection strength, actually. So depending on the type of facing, whether it is a block or a panel, then depending on the type of geosynthetic, different types of connections are there like that. This shows one type, what is known as a frictional connection. So which means the geosynthetic is just put between two layers of blocks, actually. So the weight of the block develops friction. So the connection strength is developed because of friction. Or we can put some type of mechanical fixtures also. Both are possible. So in the design, we have to ensure, actually, we have to determine what is the tension in the reinforcement at the connection. Excuse me. then we have to compare it with the connection strength actually. So again, for connection strength, there are tests actually, like this is for the frictional type like that. There are two blocks we can see. The geosynthetic is put in between, a normal force is applied. So this is like a very similar to a pullout test. The pullout test was geosynthetics was pulled out from the soil actually. So here the geosynthetic is pulled out from between the blocks actually like that. So we apply different normal force, then measure the pullout force like that. So again shows the equipment actually like. So the result, this is something like our in our direct shear test, we express something like similar concept, like we the normal load, that means the vertical load on the facing, then the pullout force or the connection capacity like that. So this shows like as this is more or less based on friction, as the normal load increases, the connection load also increases, but it's not a straight line actually. Like it's a more complicated relationship we can see like that, sort of a bilinear data. Then for design, we can sort of idealize actually, like one segment increases linearly, then at another slope, then finally it becomes, this is the maximum connection strength like that. So an idealized parameter. So from the, once we have this curve actually, when we do the design actually, depending on the depth at which the layer is placed, we can calculate the normal load. Then we can come to this curve, then we can pick up the connection capacity like that. So that can be compared with the connection load. We can determine the factor safety. Like. Then again, we have to check for serviceability. That means how much the wall deforms actually. So settlement is one aspect, then it may deform horizontally also because the reinforcement continues to deform with time. So how much will it deform? Like if it becomes excessive, that is not acceptable. So the post-construction creep strains, that means after the construction is completed with the time, how much deformation will occur? For that, we have this concept of isochronous curves actually. Again, these are creep tests actually. So at different stress levels, how the strain develops as a function of time like that. So the y-axis is percentage strain, x-axis the applied stress as a percentage of the ultimate tensile strength like that. Then this shows our short-term tensile test. Like, so if we put a geosynthetic in a tensile testing machine and just pull it, this will be our curve like that. Then this is 1 hour like. So if then 10 hour like that, that's why it's called isochronous like that. So if I want to determine the post-construction strain, so first we have to define what is the, how much is the construction period. So let's say like 1,000 hours. We come to this curve. Then what is the applied load? From my design, I will know like what is the tension coming on the reinforcement. So I come, I pick up this, say, suppose it is something like 33%. Or 35%, I come here. So up to 1,000 hours, this is the deformation. So this is during construction like that. So after construction, this will be the deformation. So this will be our end of design life like that. So once I have this isochronous curve, we can predict the post-construction deformations. So that was about the uniaxial reinforcement. So here, these applications, so we have a very clear cut design methodology. The design methodology is very well established. The properties are well defined. The test methodology is clear. So we are very clear, like we may have any type of geosynthetics, whether HDP, polyester, knitted, woven, different types of coating. It may be made of different materials. It may look different, but ultimately we know these are the properties which are important. That is long time design strength, then the interface friction, and connection strength. So the procedures are well established. So design procedures are also well established. Test procedures are there. So there is a rational approach is always possible actually like that. So like we are fairly, things are straightforward, well defined actually. Now we are coming to the second type of applications, which is called biaxial soil reinforcement. So here when a product has to resist tension or loads in both directions, then we need a product with strength in two directions, biaxial like that. Or ideally, something like isotropic. If you have something like equal strength in all directions, this will be the perfect actually. So these type of applications like load transfer platforms, then reinforcement below isolated footings, then reinforcement of base, sub-base, ballast, blanket. Because the V loads, the area is something like an ellipse or a circle like that. So the load has to be dispersed in both the directions. So we need a biaxial reinforcement. So all these applications, we need a biaxial soil reinforcement. So again, different types of product, like one is the polypropylene integral geogrids. Like again, made from a sheet of polypropylene, holes, put holes, then it's stretched in both directions. So the apertures are square like that. This shows a strength range, something like 20 to 40 kilonewton per meter, because we don't need very high strengths here like that. Elongation, then the different aperture size, then the junction efficiency. That means compared to the rip strength, if I test the junctions, almost 95%. That means these are integral monolithic junctions like that. Then polypropylene laid by actual geogrids. So strips of polypropylene, then they are welded at the junctions like that. So different strength ranges. Elongation is less, that means more tensile modulus. Then this also will have different aperture sizes. Then third category is woven knitted PVC coated polyester biaxial geogrids actually. So here we can go to higher strengths actually, from 20 into 20, that means to 200 into 200 type of strength is possible. Then we can have different aperture sizes. Only here the junction strengths are relatively low actually, because these are not monolithic actually. Like these are actually by weaving or knitting, which is not very strong, plus the coating like that. So the junctions are not very strong, but it works in a different way. Like it is not that all will need equal junction strength. Like different products work in different ways. In some products, in these type of products, junction efficiency is required actually. That is the way it works actually. Whereas in these type of products, the junction efficiency is not that important. It works in a different way. Then we can have composites actually, biaxial geogrid bonded to a non-woven geotextile, so it can perform multiple functions actually. Then this is called Triax. Again, this was by the Tensar company. So initially they invented the biaxial geogrids. So normally what companies do, like if a product is patented, so normally they tend to have a monopoly, like there is a commercial advantage, like many companies try to do that. So the intellectual property gives a lot of commercial value like that. So they develop this product. Like they say, this is superior to biaxial. Like, so the idea is like, see, normally in the case of biaxial, like it has strength in two directions actually, but here it has strength in all these axes. Like, so it becomes more isotropic. That is the concept, basic idea like that. But there are claims and counterclaims like that. Like this company claims this is much better than biaxial grid, but then the biaxial people claim, so the ribs have become much more thinner like that. So it is weaker like that. So there are claims and counterclaims. So I am not going to that. But the basic idea is this. Then there are polypropylene woven geotextiles. We have seen earlier, like in the biaxial means, it'll have these yarns will have equal strength in both directions, like a composite geotextile. Then the geocells, like these are actually like we have like strips of geomembranes, like mostly made of HDP. So then it will have perforations which allows water to flow through this. Then they are welded intermittently like that. So it will come in a collapse form like this. Then at the side it is expanded and filled with the granular subbase or base like that. So here it literally confines actually, the aggregate is within the geocells, it confines like that. So HDP is most commonly used, But then there are some companies which develop proprietary different types of alloys and like that. And again, there are a lot of claims. Actually, if you search in the internet, you will see big arguments between different companies, like claiming this material is better, like that. Then there are also non-woven geosols, which are mostly used for erosion control, like that, not for this stabilization reinforcement applications. Then if we come to the important properties, tensile strength at 2% elongation. So see, normally in the case of uniaxial, we look at the long-term design strength. The ultimate strength was important because it was, the purpose was to prevent failure like that. But whereas in these applications, mainly it is to control deformations. In the case of roads or railway tracks, the applied loads are not sufficiently high to cause a failure of the reinforcement. But the purpose of the reinforcement is to control deformations. That means we need a high tensile modulus. So the ultimate strength, which may occur at an elongation of 10% or 12%, that is not much significant. The tensile modulus that is more relevant, like that. Then junction efficiency. As I mentioned, for geogrids, the integral type of monolithic type of geogrid, this is a very important property. Then aperture size. See, normally there has to be an interaction between the aggregate and the geogrid apertures. So the aggregate, the aperture should be sufficiently large so that the aggregate can penetrate into the aperture. At the same time, it should not be too large like that. So one criteria is the aperture should be larger than the average particle size, so the D50 of the aggregate. And it should be less than 2 times the maximum particle size, some sort of criteria like that. Then the aperture stability modulus, we will see that. These two properties we will see. So here, when the geogrid, it is subjected to traffic stresses, the weed loads actually, like that. So the load magnitude as the weed load moves, these are moving loads, it varies. And it has seen that it induces sort of a twisting deformation on the ribs, actually, like that, something like a torsion, a twisting deformation. So if the geogrids, like normally what happens, the stresses are there, the particles will penetrate into the apertures, and there is an interlocking, actually. So the particles will try to push and deform the ribs, actually, like that. So the geogrids with high in-plane torsional rigidity will have better interlocking, and it will offer better lateral restraint. That is the concept, actually. There's a test, like aperture stability modulus test, like ASTM standard is there. So we can see the detail, like that the particular junction that is gripped, and we tried to twist it like that. So the torque divided by the rotation, like we apply a certain torque and measure the angle by how much it has twisted, that will define the stiffness. Actually, it is expressed in like Newton meter, that is the torque, and degree, what is the rotation like, kind of like that. And see, normally, as I mentioned earlier, like in the case of reinforced soil walls, slopes, the design methods are well established like that. But unfortunately, in the case of the base reinforcement, like the reinforced pavement design or track bed design, we have not developed that much. It is much more complicated, actually. But one method is there, like the geode hand method for designing geogrid reinforced unpaved roads. So this aperture stability modulus is one of the parameter, actually, like that. So it goes into the equation, like, so this is. Otherwise, it is much more empirical, like we don't know, like which property is important, how to design, the mechanistic design methods are less developed, actually. Because we know that like the pavement design itself, earlier it used to be highly empirical. Only now we are talking about the mechanistic empiristic method. But the geosynthetic reinforced, it is yet to reach that stage, actually. The radial stiffness, the concept again, it was introduced by the Straksh people. So suppose I measure, suppose there is a biaxial. So along the machine direction, there will be tensile modulus. Then I do a transverse rib, again the tensile modulus for different, the envelope will be like this, actually. So along the machine direction, I measure the tensile modulus, plot it. So in a bag shell, it will be two directions like that. So the stiffness will be something like that conceptually. Whereas here, because there are rips in more directions, like it will be more isotropic like that. So there is a, it is a more isotropic product. So it is more effective. That's what the tracks people claim actually like that. But again, there are a lot of arguments in both ways. So again, I'm not going into that actually. So see, one option is from these type of mechanistic design. So that means from the properties of the product, like we can, if you have an equation, we can design that. So the Giroud-Hand method is one such method, which is based on the upper stability modulus. See, other than that, most of the methods are empirical approach actually. So here what we do, like we do a trafficking test. That means we have both unreinforced road control sections as well as reinforced road, like different products, different layer thicknesses like that, then subjected to traffic actually. Like some people do in the lab also, like in a tank, put this and do a repeated loading test like that. Then the results are expressed like one is a layer coefficient ratio. So that means if you know the ASHTO payment design methodology, different layers, like if it is a bituminous layer, it has a layer coefficient, like granular base has a 0.14, like a granular subbase has 0.1 or 0.11 like that. So then we do the same test, like the reinforced layer also, we determine the layer coefficient ratio. So the layer coefficient, the ratio becomes the layer coefficient. That means layer coefficient of the reinforced layer divided by the layer coefficient of the unreinforced layer. So that is the LCR actually. So once we know the LCR, then we can always determine the layer coefficient of the reinforced layer. So the manufacturer will give some trafficking test, either lab test or field test, and they'll give the value of LCR. From that, we can do the design actually. These are empirical approaches. Another approach is traffic benefit ratio. Again, so normally for any payment section, there is a allowable equivalent axle load actually. So from the trafficking test for the unreinforced payment, we determine what is allowable ESL. Then again, for the reinforced, we do the same thing. The ratio becomes the traffic benefit ratio like that. Another is a modulus improvement factor, because the mechanistic method is based on the resilient modulus actually like that. So the ratio of the resilient modulus of the reinforced layer and to that of the resilient modulus of the unreinforced layer, that is a modulus improvement factor like that. So these are all actual performance parameters based from actual test actually. But then, and this can go into the either if you have the LCR, then we can design using the ASHTO payment methodology. If you have the modulus improvement factor, we can use the mechanistic empiristic method, that is possible like that. But then we should have, it is an empirical method. So the validity depends on what condition it has been tested and what is the actual payment we are going to design. There has to be both has to be on the same line. Then only these parameters will be reliable like that. So as I mentioned earlier, this, See, we need this field. Like we have a lot of products actually, but then the in terms of design or theory, the developments are much less compared to the reinforced soil structures. Reinforced soil walls and slopes, they're much developed. But here, because the design is much more complicated actually, payment design is much more complicated compared to a retaining wall design or a slope design like that. So that is one of the issues here actually. But it is slowly developing, like people are using it because problem is there. We have to have solutions, but in terms of design, like we need much more improvement. Another application is asphalt reinforcement. Like the geosynthetic reinforcement is put in the asphalt concrete layer, bituminous concrete layer. So here the idea is to reduce reflection cracking, reduce fatigue cracking, then reduce rutting. And in some cases, like when we use with a geotextile also, like it becomes a moisture barrier like that. When the if there is a non-woven geotextile, so it will absorb the bitumen, then it becomes like an impervious membrane actually. So it will not allow the moisture to go into the base or sub-base or the subgrade like that. So the reflection cracking is, suppose the existing damaged pavement is there. So we are putting an overlay, bituminous overlay over that. So at the existing cracks, there are stress concentrations actually. So over a period of time, this crack will slowly propagate into the overlay like that. This is called reflection cracking. So the life of overlay becomes limited actually. So there are different solutions. Use thick overlay, then there are steps SAMI like that, paving fabrics like that. So asphalt reinforcement is one technique to reduce reflection cracking like that. So here what happens, the crack in the case of reinforced, the crack can propagate into the overlay. But here, because if the reinforcement has a very high tensile modulus, then the crack cannot propagate it. It is just deflected horizontally like that. It cannot propagate into the layer. That is a concept. And even fatigue cracking, another failure mechanisms like that. So if there is a reinforcement here, it can prevent or delay the fatigue cracking like that. But again, it depends from where the crack is originating, whether it's from the top or from the bottom like that. So if our reinforcement is at the bottom and crack is propagating from here, then it will not be effective like that. So again, there are here also in the asphalt reinforcement also, the design methodology is yet to be developed. A mechanistic design procedure is nowadays we are designing based on experience by precedent. You make an installation, monitor the performance, from that we get an idea like that. So it is the design methodology is not very advanced in the case of asphalt reinforcement. But performance has shown actually that the benefit is known, actual people do the trial installations from that, the benefit. But then how to quantify that, how to relate it to the mechanistic properties of the product, that is again, so shows the performance of different products actually. See, normally the glass fiber grids, it has got very high tensile modulus. So because the asphalt is a relatively brittle material, fails at a low strain. So we need a reinforcement which mobilizes tension at a very low elongation. So that is why the glass are very popular for asphalt reinforcements. So the applications like asphalt overlays on distressed flexible pavements. Every time a bituminous pavement is damaged, we come and put an overlay on top of that. So there we can use this reinforcement. Then asphalt overlays over distressed concrete pavements also we can use. Then we can here the full coverage, the entire pavement can be covered with the reinforcement, but we can also cover with strips like asphalt overlays over jointed concrete pavements. So we can put the reinforcement across the joints really, because reflection cracks are likely there. Then sometimes lane widening, when we existing road and new road at that that along that joint, there are problems. So there we can put the reinforcement. Then patches like pothole repairs, manhole covers, etc. So the full coverage. So here we can see the strips along the, this is a a jointed concrete road. So along the joints, we can see the reinforcements. Something like a manhole cover like that. So repair for that, we can put a circular strip kind of thing, reinforcement. Then coming the products again, different types of products, we can see one by one. Long back, we used to have this PP grids like that. See, normally what happens is when a product is developed, that is only available. So people try to use it for all sorts of applications like that. May not be the perfect product, but at that time, that was only available, we used it. So initially this being used, but nowadays it is less actually. More and more it is glass type of product. same type of biaxial geogrid like that, grid plus composite also. Then polyester grids, geotextile composite, like a polyester grid with a non-woven geotextile which is bonded. Then it is coated with the bitumen also. And people have used steel meshes, like McCaffrey has a product like road mesh like that. So same double stud mesh which is used for bigging cabins, then which is reinforced with steel rods in the other direction. Like we can see that product. Like then one of the most popular product is glass fiber grids with coated with bitumen or polymer like that. So different strengths like 50 100 200 like that. Then glass elongation at breaks are like 2 to 2.5%. That means very high tensile modulus. So that is why it is being used for bitumen. Then aperture size. Then initially people use coating because the glass fiber has to bond with the bituminous concrete. So bitumen. And why do we need a coating? See, one is to give dimensional stability to the grid, actually, because the grid is either woven or knitted. So it will because the ribs may not retain the shape like that. So when it's coated, it becomes more dimensionally stable like that. Then protection of glass fibers from mechanical damage, like because glass is a very sensitive, brittle material. So it needs protection like that. Then bonding of the grid with the asphalt pavement like that. So one issue with the bitumen, it will soften at about 90 to 95 degree, whereas the paving temperature will be something like 120 to 140. So when you place the hot mix asphalt onto the bitumen coated grid, the bitumen will soften like that. Then it will not be able to perform this protection function like that, because once the bitumen softens, it becomes there could be damage like that. Then bitumen also, it is very sensitive to temperature like that. So nowadays, like most of the products, they go for polymer coating, which is superior to bitumen coating like that. Then another improvement is the existing pavement surface is there. Onto that, the fiberglass grid has to be laid, and it has to bond with that this one. Then the bituminous concrete is put, and it has to be compacted like that. So if the grid doesn't stick to the layer below, while this next layer is being paved, it may just come up actually. So then it'll become a total mess actually. Like so. For that, they put this pressure-sensitive adhesive backing. Like so, on the coating at the back surface, this is a pressure-sensitive adhesive like that. So when you apply a vertical pressure, the adhesive hardens and it gets bonded like that. So normally, when this rubber tire, this vehicle moves over the grid, it applies a pressure and the adhesive gets activated, and the layer is bonded to the layer below like that. Then another improvement is what is called like a tack film like that. So here, like the tack film is a thin polymeric membrane bonded to the grid like that. So at the bottom, it is a pressure sensitive adhesive like that. At the top is this tack film like that. So this has got a relatively low melting temperature. So when the hot bituminous mix is put on that, this will soften and mostly melt like that. Then it gives better bonding with the bituminous layer like that. And you can also avoid tack coat. Like, so what it makes insulation faster, easier, and improves performance also like that. Then this type of products are there, like coated fiberglass grid plus a non-woven geotextile composite. Like, so the grid acts as the reinforcement. Then the fabric acts as a moisture barrier like that. It absorbs bitumen, it becomes impervious, so multiple functions. Like. Then another product is uncoated fiberglass grid, like the glass fiber yarns only with a non-woven geotextile composite like that. So the important properties are like one, tensile strength, then tensile modulus is very important, then the bond strength and bond stiffness with asphalt, again important. Stability at high and low temperatures, durability, than easy installation like that. As I mentioned earlier, see, one issue with this, sometimes what happens, like if the product, it has a lot of wrinkles, or while paving, it comes up actually, then it will create a mess actually, and it probably, it may do more harm than good. So insulation is very, very important in this case. So an experienced insulation contractor is very important. Then another issue is milling. Like sometimes, like the once after some time, the existing pavement has to be milled and recycled actually like that. So the product should be such that it does not affect milling. So see, normally the fiberglass grids, milling is not an issue like that. So again, in India, it is, there are many manufacturers like that, and some projects have been used, but still it has not caught on to that extent. But other countries, it is being used like that. But again, as I mentioned, one lacune is that the design methods are yet to be developed. Actually, there is no mechanistic design procedure. So the products are recommended being used based on experience, like mostly based on experience. Like another application we'll go quickly is the reinforced vegetation. So, excuse me. Soil erosion is a big problem like we face in fill slopes, like embankments, highway embankments, railway embankments, cut slopes, natural slopes, then other like flood protection structures like embankments, dikes, levees, then waterways, canals, streams. But see, all this due to rainwater, here due to flowing water, and in the case of coastal, due to wave action, like different. So it becomes more severe this way. So due to surface runoff, currents, waves, erosion is a problem. Then coming to solutions, like hard armor, like either based on stone or rock, like riprap or rock filled gabions, mattresses. Then we have concrete based, like articulated concrete blocks, grout filled geotextile mattresses. Then another interesting new product is geosynthetic cementitious composite mats. One product is called concrete canvas. This is something very similar to geosynthetic clay liners. I don't know whether you heard about the geosynthetic clay liner. Like we have a within two layers of geotextile, we put bentonite powder. So when this bentonite powder hydrates, it becomes saturated. It becomes an impervious liner, very popular for landfills and other barrier applications. So here, similar concept actually. So here we have a dry cementitious powder within a fabric like that. So when it hydrates, it hardens, like it becomes concrete, sort of a ready-made concrete like that. So very thin, relatively thin material. Then tetrapod like that. Then geotextile tubes, containers, etc. We can go for soil stabilization, bitumen cement stabilization. And one option is vegetation, like. So that is our topic, like see how vegetation increases resistance to erosion. Like see above the ground, the stem, leaves, and even the residue, like the dead leaves, etc. It absorbs the energy of the raindrops. Then it reduces velocity actually. Like then below the ground, the root system, it binds the soil particles together. It allows, because it water to infiltrate actually into the ground. Then more plant growth means more transpiration, like it reduces soil moisture. Like all these effects contribute, but we are going to focus on this root system reinforcement like that. So many a times, simple vegetation may work, like just grow grass or other plants, but sometimes we need, whether in the case of steeper slopes, or the soil conditions are not favorable, like we need erosion control blanket or mats. What this do is it offers protection till vegetation is established. Then the seeds also, it will take some time for grow. So till that, it holds the seeds and assists the growth of it. It retains soil moisture, some products like that. Then the biodegradable, like jute or coir, when it degrades, it becomes nutrients or conditioners for the soil. Then with these mats, we can have higher root density than ordinary vegetation. Then the mesh, reinforces the root system. So it increases the resistance to erosion. Then coming to the products, one is erosion control blankets, what we call temporary. So that means it will, after some time, it will degrade and decay. So we have natural jute and coir geotextiles. So jute will decay fast. Coir, when treated, it may last, say, 3 to 4 years or 5 years like that. Then again, we have coir woven and non-woven. Then we have some synthetic. So I mentioned, if plastics, when exposed to sunlight, will degrade with time. So if we don't add any UV stabilizers, within a few years, it will degrade. So that's called photodegradable. That means degradable under sunlight. Then we have permanent, like turf reinforcement mats, like that we call. Then geocells. So basically, we are going to focus on the reinforcement. So we are not going to talk about coir or jute, because these are degradable, these are not permanent. So we cannot depend on the reinforcement function. So again, different types of these are the three-dimensional arrangements of filaments like that. So one particular company's product, they have different versions of that. So normal mat, then this is reinforced. So where we need more higher tensile strength, we can layer. Then this is sort of a pre-filled mat, so this can be pre-filled with aggregates and bonded with bitumen. So it will give erosion protection, and it is pervious, vegetation can grow through that. So the idea is, even in case vegetation does not establish, this will give erosion protection. If vegetation grows, will end good like that. Different types of turf reinforcement mats, different arrangements. These are more or less three-dimensional. These type of structures are there. And these have a life of up to, say, 30 years, 50 years, depending on the composition of the fibers and the UV stabilizers added. Even up to, companies give a life of up to 30, 50 years, etc., depending on the product. So when do you use turf reinforcement mat? See, if certain cases, if nothing is required, if it's a really flat slope, if the velocity flow is very less, we can use normal vegetation itself. But slightly more conditions, we can use erosion control blankets, like a coir mat or a jute mat like that. So it will help to establish vegetation, and after 3-4 years, it will degrade and go, no problem. After that, the root system will take care like that. But if the unreinforced vegetation cannot safely withstand erosive forces, use permanent TRM like that. So this is normally required for streams or ditches, when there are higher velocity flows, high velocity currents are there required. So normal slopes, like an embankment slopes, our jute or coir would be sufficient. But for a ditch lining or a stream bank lining, we may have to go for a TRM like that. So the TRM stabilized vegetation is an alternative to hard armor. So compared to hard armor, when we're using, instead of riprap or sort of a gabion mattress, why should we go for TRM reinforced vegetation? Sometimes it is cheaper. This figure is for the US. They're given it is 50% cost of riprap and 25% that of concrete based solutions like that. Then much lighter and easier to transport and install. Easier maintenance, then increase stormwater filtration, infiltration like that. Because when water flows through vegetation root systems, it gets filtered like that. There is another benefit. Then most important is it's aesthetically pleasing, environmentally friendly, and ecologically functional. Compared to a riprap or concrete liner, a green system is always, from an ecological point of view, always superior. Then another concept is, next level is armored reinforced vegetation system. So these type of turf reinforcement mats combined with soil anchors like that. So that is called armored reinforced vegetation system. So the slope stability come erosion protection like that. So we can, this type of anchors we can see, the sort of cable anchors, these are pushed These are sort of self-drilling anchors pushed into the ground, pneumatically driven into the ground. Then the cable is tensioned and locked into the position like that. So it induces sort of a compressive stresses also the ground, stabilizing it. Like, so one company, this is a US company, like a Propex, like that, they give a product selection guide, like see up to some like do nothing may be required. So like this shows actually the shear stress, like the when the water flows, it induces a shear stress. So as the shear stress increases, the possibility of erosion increases actually. So we need more and more high performance solutions like that. Another interesting concept, again by the same company, is known as a pira wall, like that. The turf reinforcement mat, they have combined into a reinforced soil structure. So the turf reinforcement mat is used as a facing cum reinforcement, actually, with a sort of a fiberglass composite brackets like this, stiffeners like this, like that. So the reinforcement plus facing is the same product, actually. The brackets facilitate compaction because soil has to be placed and compacted. So this gives a stiffening for that. So this shows the completed. After that, vegetation can be grown on that, like that. So another, instead of TRM, we can also go for geocells, like reinforced vegetation. Like we can go grass. So this this company, like Sachi Geosynthetics, they have done a project near Delhi, like geocell combined with vetiver grass, actually, like that. Because we know the vetiver grass has a very root, deep and root root system, very deep and strong root system. So that is geocell to have a, because this is sort of a channel lining like that. We need a good performing system. Now we come to the last application is, I mentioned about concrete. I'll just show one slide actually. Like, so here, as I mentioned, like we are not, like in a building, in an RCC slab, we are not going to put a like geosynthetic reinforcement, but something like a pedestrian walkway or ground support slabs where like, the heavy reinforcement is not required, where the reinforcement is only intended to prevent the shrinkage or temperature cracks, like we can consider this. So I'm a consultant to this company. They're based in Canada. So like for a in a city, they did a research project actually, like the concrete sidewalks, tried various combinations. So it is a fiberglass grid with a polymeric coating like that. Again, for concrete reinforcement, we need a high stiffness product. So that's why they went for a fiberglass product. So different locations, one was at the bottom of the slab, then middle of the slab, and at the top of the slab like that. So after 1 year, they look at the performance, it is performing well like that. Like applications. So with that, let us conclude. So we have looked at the applications of uniaxial geosynthetic reinforcement, mainly for reinforced soil walls, slopes, and basal reinforcement. We have seen variety of products like different types of geogrids, geotextiles, composites. And here, it is a well-established, like we have a mechanistic design method, the test procedures are well-established. So how to evaluate the products, we know like which properties are important, how to use it in a design is very clear like that. Then we also seen biaxial geosynthetic reinforcement, the foundation reinforcement, and mainly the reinforcement of unbound aggregates for roads and railway tracks. So here, like we know the product works, like we have a general idea how it behaves, but how to, the mechanistic design methods are still evolving actually. So how to relate the rationally relate the product properties to the actual design. So still some gap is there actually. So with time probably, so I think it's a good area for research where it's really, really required actually. Then asphalt reinforcement, we have seen again the same situation, like the benefits are understood, the experimental, the field evidence is there. But again, the mechanistic design methods are lacking, actually, like turf reinforcement applications we have seen. Again, another application is the concrete secondary reinforcement. So like we have seen, like basically the reinforcement is only one of the functions like that. Similarly, there are so many other functions. So it's a vast field, like so many types of products with so much the different applications with so much potential like that. So we are still exploring only part of the potential like that. But what has changed is in India, like the manufacturing has really caught on, like all these products, probably except the turf reinforcement mats. Most of the other products are indigenously being manufactured. There are several manufacturers like Techfab, Strata, McCaffrey, Maruti, like that. Many manufacturers are there. Like Techfab is one of the largest. They're manufacturing most of the products like that. So like the products are available in India. So it is up to us to how to use that actually like that. So with that, I conclude. Thank you for the patient listening, and my contact details are there. I'll be happy to answer any questions. And later on also, if you like to ask any questions, you're free to contact me on email. So once again, I thank you to all the participants and to the organizers also for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Jimmy sir, for your wonderful and informative session. Now the platform is open for the participants. If you would like to ask the question or any query, you can.